arrived. This is the Select Board meeting of the Town of Ashfield on Monday, the 7th day of December at the Town Hall. And all I see is one audio recording device. Anybody else have any?
Video.
And one video device. Brian, you haven't been here on a regular basis, so I fall out of rhythm. All right? Good. We've got one set of minutes to approve, to take care of, address. Everybody's had a chance to read them. Besides the D being changed to P on the MCAP portion, that was one little change that I had. Anybody else have any comments?
I was wondering, Lynn talked about already, Attorney General's study next year.
Oh, okay.
On page 2 and 4. Liaison reports on page 3, simple little one, but I like what the intending A, or
A.
I know it's not B.
Yeah.
And that's all I have.
I had none of those. I'm still looking for, there it is.
And it sounds like we're not in Pimple, so is it spelled correctly?
Isn't it MAC? That stood out to me. I didn't know if it was, but it was, it looks right.
I think it's right.
You think it's right?
Yeah.
Oh.
Oh, okay.
I think the motion to accept those amendments.
I'll second that.
Any other discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Unanimous. Highway superintendent was really anxious not to take too much time, but he's not here. He doesn't want to get stuck behind all the other traffic. Here he is. Whoo! You got here right after the wire, Tom.
Look.
You almost stuck behind all the other traffic for tonight. So, first things first, have you had any luck out hunting?
That was a phone in the China pool. Let's get out there and go, no deer.
No deer? No deer for you?
No deer, yeah. Let's see if we can use the rest of the table.
So, you want to bring us up to date on buying this sweeper?
Yes. So, we opened it up. We advertised.
So I guess it doesn't work. $55,000 for a used street sweeper? And how much money did we appropriate?
We appropriated $75,000 for a sweeper and a mower.
And a what?
Mower. Here's a, I have a couple pictures of it.
Oh, why I had $35,000 in my mind. Is that what you were thinking the mower was going to be?
No, we were thinking of more than right around 20 or 25. So here's the original trip right here.
So we only got one bid.
We got one bid. really had batteries from two companies, one was in Texas. They asked for good documents, but we did not submit a bid. I don't know if it would, something that you guys might send me out to Texas for a winter to see.
Well, we might have no problem.
You wouldn't like it once you got there.
Yeah, we received one bid.
What year is it?
2004. That was it. I reviewed the bid documents, and these are specifications, and I find that CNO is a responsible bidder. I've seen the machine, Al and I went to the town of Huntsville, who was the previous owner of the machine. We checked it out, ran around the yard, and it appears to be a very nice condition.
What year is the one that we're operating now?
1985. Has, well, obviously this would be upgrades, that's much tighter, so less cost. It was helping the machine to operate, stop operating. It's, they've done a lot of improvements on the washdown system. Ours doesn't need to be really out of the washdown system, but you have to do it if you wash it all by hand. This has a washdown system and an automatic greaser. So I really anticipate that this would probably save an hour to an hour and a half pounds a day compared to the machine to go to work. So,
well, I was wondering about if we go ahead with this, that I don't see any arrangements on disposal of our old machine.
It's traded. If you look at the back, I guess not the next page from the back.
Oh, trade allowance, $5,000.
Yes.
Good. Last thing we need is to accumulate more junk around that nobody wants it.
Exactly. No, it's, that was one of the specs that we would be trading in.
Do they pick it up when they deliver?
Yeah.
So you're going to end up with $20,000 left in that account to try to address your mower situation?
Exactly.
Is that going to work?
I believe so, yeah. I have a quote for a mower that's about 20, I think about that. But in that ballpark, it's an old quote, it's from July, but I wanted to address the sweeper first and see how much money I got left before we went after the mower.
You kept your ear to the rail, so you're figuring this is as good a machine as you've been able to run across?
Yep.
Why did Monson move on with it?
They're getting a brand new one.
After
that? They update things maybe a little more regularly than Ashfield MA.
And does the hours on it, does it keep track of hours or miles or what? Is it in line with what you'd expect for that year?
Yeah, we asked for a machine with our specifications with less than 3,000 hours.
Well, I can see it's got hydraulic drive on it and so forth, so I'm guessing that if a chain breaks, you don't go sailing down the hill or...
Yes, much. It's a bigger move than what we have. So my recommendation would be to award the bid to the CNO.
I make a motion to accept this bid for a used highway sweeper from CN Wood for the amount of $55,000.
Perfect. Actually, after the trade-in, it's $50,000.
I'll second that. Any other discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Unanimous. Great, Tom. I'm glad to have that. Isn't it nice to have it taken care of instead of waiting until the week before you need it?
Yes.
Before you scoop, Tom, is there anything we need to know about anything else going on in the department?
There's a couple things I wanted to... go over there real quickly if you could. This is just a... sort of FYI type of thing. The funds that we received from Murphy Cycling for several years have always gone to, which in that packet, you'll see that we've got a check for $1,700. And there's a change that I just wanted to bring to your attention. Those funds in the past have always gone to the HRMC. And recently, the HRMC board decided to, instead of the HRMC receiving those funds, to have those funds go directly to the town. And the reason for that primarily is that some of the towns have gone to single stream recycling. We have not. When they go to single stream recycling, they do not receive those funds. So we thought it was unfair for all the number of towns in the HRMC that some are single stream and some are dual stream. We thought the best solution was to have the funds go directly to the town. But what that means is, these funds previously have been used mostly for maintaining roll-off containers and even occasionally purchasing a new one. So that is a bridge that we have to be crossed now. I can foresee that we might have to pony up some money to maintain some of these roll-off containers. But
in what way?
They might need patching, welding. Some of them are in pretty tough conditions and are pretty old or impossible to replace them. So some years ago, Ashfield decided to go to three containers for recycling. You might recall that we purchased one of our own. So we have three.
That was three or 4 years ago, right?
3 years ago.
I don't think it was one of them. So we have three roll-off containers at the transfer station for recycling, and two are owned by HRMC, and one is owned by the town of Ashfield. So I don't think we've quite decided how exactly we're going to maintain them through the HRMC. The HRMC owned containers. We've definitely decided that we're going to take this money and give it directly to the towns. As an example, West Hampton, for example, is a single thing, so they would not. Receive it, but we didn't feel it was fair for us to go to the HRMC. There's benefits to the single stream that they feel they're better off there.
Well, that's, they don't have to segregate it, right? That's what the last sentence is. Right.
So for now, that's where that stands, so that's why we received that money. Sort of going along right along with that, there's this recycling dividend program. The DEP and I'm going to give Tom
we're going to win more. So I claim the lottery.
Well, they want to give us $2,100. Thank you. Probably, this is letters back in September, Tom, but you probably just, I don't know if you remember, but you had that.
Pursuant to the Green Communities Act, municipalities earned a payment of $2,100. They normally just don't give you money, they tie something to it, right?
Well, we have to, yeah, we have to track expenses and submit them to the DEP.
Municipals receive payments according to the number of criteria points their program earns. RDP provides an incentive for municipalities with poor recycling programs to do better by implementing best practices, and it rewards communities with model recycling and waste reduction programs. So at some point, somebody's going to tell us that this $2,100 is the former or the latter, right? Either we got a poor one or we've got a good model. Well, it says it provides an incentive for municipalities with poor programs to do better, and then it rewards communities with model recycling and waste reduction programs. So, but I don't know if it tells us right here what this $2,100 is, because we do a good job or because we do a poor job.
We do a good job. So we have, it's based on this point system.
Since our contamination issue with oil, waste oil, where are we now with waste oil? That people bring it to the transfer station? Can they dump it or do they leave it? What do?
They leave it.
They leave it in?
They leave it in a gallon tub there. A gallon of stuff is still in the pan, so put their drugs in a tub and then they put it in.
Is it tested at all as they put it in or not really? Because we had some PCP problems, or
yeah. We don't really have a lot of
testing.
Testing equipment.
jugs, like, you know, containers or something like that?
Yeah, or oil jugs that are, you know.
So, I haven't been able to read this over in detail, but they expecting us to sign this to accept the $2,100?
Yes.
And are we?
I can enter into this program by the looks of it.
But are we supposed to use the $2,100 to do something so we can improve our score for next year to get $2,600?
Go to page two. There's a number eight, use of funds, and then we go down just below that. There's a bullet list there of approved equipment and activities that you can use to spend the money on. So, and like I said, one of them was roll-off containers. And it says this includes replacement of existing equipment, so I'm taking it that means you can use that money for also for maintaining it. Doesn't really specifically say that, but it does say this includes replacement of existing equipment, so.
But now that I see the scorecard on page four, I'm wondering if the idea is that you spend this money to improve something so your scorecard next year will be better. And if you get too high a score, instead of paying you $200 for every point, they'll only pay you $150. I mean, it's great that we got some grant money.
Yeah.
Just trying to figure out what we're going to spend it on.
Well, they also have this, I'm looking at the last two bullets here, swap shop. You know, that can be managed properly without just getting a bunch of junk, and people can bring stuff that's usable and other people can do it. We can improve our score that way. And waste reduction or recycling outreach and education materials. I mean, we're spending money on that sort of stuff all the time, you know, so it makes sense to try to get reimbursed and improve our score. I think it's a good idea. It points us in the right direction and reach a little further.
I think we have a complex issue going on down there, as you're aware of. This is a pretty small dollar now compared to what may or may not happen. We haven't heard back from DEP on the corrective actions analysis plan that we submitted for that.
It's 25% of the $8,000 plan.
Right. The swap shop's a good point. The swap shop, if we really don't know the swap shop right correctly, it should be under cover, it should have shells,
right.
So there's a long list of eligible expenses there, and a lot of them, I can see the need for in the future, so it could be the need relatively soon, so it could be a lot. But the good thing is that we don't have to spend money in the fiscal year.
That's great.
So, actually, I was going to talk to Joyce about setting up that account that we speak of, and I was also going to talk to her about this money that the $1,700 I received for recycling. I'm assuming probably has to go into the general fund at this point, but I was going to talk to her about that, if that can also go into this account. Or maybe we'd have to have a special town meeting to transfer it, but it seems like an appropriate account.
Sure, since we know we're going to have expenses there.
Yeah. What would you call that? Other than just transfer station, we already have
dump fund.
But I mean, would you say carryover account or something like that?
Ron, I haven't spent 1 second thinking about what to call it.
It has to be unique, is what I'm trying to say.
Well,
this $2,100 would be RDP grant.
Yeah.
Fund. Let's check with Joyce about how to set that up. I'm sure we're not the only municipality that she's had to work with.
Yeah, let's talk to her about that.
Yeah. I'd like to make a motion to authorize the chair to sign on behalf of the select board this RDP contract that's before us, and set up a special fund for receiving payments.
At least we'll sign this and get it coming.
Yeah.
Second. Any other discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Unanimous. Well, you can stay a little while longer. You brought us $4,000 so far, so let's top that.
That's the end of the income.
That's the end of the gravy train? It doesn't feel much like it. How are you doing on winter roads and getting them all set up? And
we're in good shape. We're putting this all ready. The whips, our snow ball markers are going well. We're about 99% complete with that. The sand shed is full. The sanders are all. All sanders are, well, the slide sanders remain, but all the trucks are set up and we're ready to go.
So what do you get the guys working on since there's no side in the winter? We got General Highway or Chapter 90?
Well, we just finished up some works. Today we've been, we're going to be starting leaves. We got a lot of leaves. That's one thing we're looking at is enough leaves, but it's going to work out really because of the weather. So we're going to go on the leaf blowing. We're in pretty good shape with the blowing leaves on the side of the roads, on the ground roads, and roads we can blow on. But we've got to start getting some of these center town.
Talk about getting them out of the ditches and culverts.
Yeah, we're going to do all the culverts. We've got a pretty good style of culverts. We've got that probably. Probably third way on that one.
Well, it sounds like you got another good week and maybe another one behind it.
I hope so.
Not very good.
We got plenty of other guys around the bears to do.
You got squared away with Smith Road on the curb cut. They were looking for you last week.
Yeah, I think we're good there. So, yeah, it's been busy. It's been good year.
See what winter brings. Maybe an open winter.
That's what they were doing.
Anything else for us, Tom?
Nope.
Thanks for coming in. Glad we could.
Good.
May as well not dilly dally around on that more, figuring out what you want to do. Right?
Yep.
Would December be a buyer's market? I'm thinking more.
Very good. All right, now we'll get into the meat of the evening here. Crocker, Bill, how are you?
I'm doing well.
How are you? I'm all right. I'm just fine. You brought some folks with you.
Yes.
You want to talk to us about something about broadband.
I know it's not.
I've heard briefly something about fiber to the home.
Yeah, I know it's not a particularly hot topic. It certainly doesn't reach the status of a new street sweeper, but we're here to tell you a little bit about it.
Good. Glad to have you.
Thank you. So what we would, we've been asked to basically kind of present our approach to broadband, and this is not the first time that I've been in front of you, so you kind of have a sense of who we are, and that we you're already aware that we're the service provider in Leverett. Leverett's now 100% complete. We're just finalizing the last phone connections, but internet has pretty much been 100% complete since the end of August. The network is working great. Everybody seems to be pretty happy. So what we will talk about tonight is kind of our approach. It's based on our Leverett experience. It can be expanded to include multiple towns. It doesn't have to be an individual town like Leverett. So there is the capability to share some administrative costs, share some other, share some expertise that one town may have and another does not. So what I thought we would do is start by kind of giving you a brief overview of our company, and then kind of get into how we would approach a community broadband opportunity, what we would do in particular for Ashfield. And here with me tonight is Matthew Crocker, who is the president of Crocker Communications, a resident of Hatfield, and Jessica Thompson, who is a salesperson that works for me at Crocker and a resident of Ashfield. And as most of you know by now, I'm one town over in Conway, so we are local. So I'd like to just kind of use this as a springboard for a conversation. I would encourage you to stop us at any point. This is not a walk through the presentation and then do Q&A. We can have questions anytime you'd like. And then for some of you, I have left updated financials based on the leverage cost recovery model. If a town owns its own assets, then the town is responsible for escrowing money, paying insurance, paying for pole licenses, and all of that is well documented and pretty well spelled out from the leverage cost recovery model. We take the three variables that every town has and use those to take the leverage approach and kind of Ashfieldize it. And those variables are number of route miles, number of telephone poles, and number of households or dwellings. And when you adjust for that, you can then apply the same approach that Leverett took to recovering the cost of its network. And you figure out what that's going to be on a given take rate. On the sheet in front of you, I've projected a 75% take rate and a 50% take rate. I'm really confident that you would be in that upper number. No reason to think it'd be much different than Leverett, which is currently at 85% take rate. And then we're just kind of walk through our approach, answer any questions, and let you guys know that you have a good, solid, viable option in Crocker Communications, no matter what other options you might explore.
Let's hit it.
All right, so I'm going to hand off to Matt and ask him to walk us through just a brief overview of the company the approach that we support when we talk to towns.
So the company started in Greenfield, 1956, with my mom, and we handled lease radios and doctor lines or in our answering service. We still have that business operating in Greenfield. August of 94, we started an internet company. That's really my baby. And then in 99, we started a phone company. So we are a full-service internet service provider operating in the Valley for the last 21 years, and a full-service phone company doing residential and commercial phone service for the last 12 years, really. We were a registered competitive local exchange carrier in 1999, but we didn't immediately start offering voice services. So our approach is really the MBI approach. It's the Leverett experience, Leverett model, but not having the towns do as much of the heavy lifting that Leverett did. Leverett did everything. They reinvented the wheels. They contracted with the construction company and project managed the whole construction project, which is a very, very intensive task. And Leverett subcontracted a lot of that to Holo Gas and Electric. With MBI, MBI is now going to be the owner's project manager. They're going to do the design and they will do and manage the construction. They'll send it out to bid. They will manage the construction project. And at the end of the day, when MBI is done and the contractors are done, they will hand over a fully installed functional network to the town that the town owns. And that's where we come in. We're operating as a network operator and or service provider. We'll do all of the retail facing pieces. So in Leverett, we do all the retail facing sales and support, invoicing, We provide the IP bandwidth, the IP addresses, the phone service, the phone numbers. We port the homeowner's existing phone number. They don't have to change their number, port it away from Verizon onto our switch. And so we provide all of that. We collect all of the money from the end user, and then we remit to the town. So the town in Leverett, there's a municipal light plant. The municipal light plant in Leverett has an operating budget of about $320,000 a year. That covers the municipal light plant's legal responsibility of depreciating an escrow account for depreciating the asset. There's pole attachment rentals, there's insurance, there's break fix and maintenance on the fiber. There's a little bit of allowed return for the MLP to make a little bit of profit, up to 8%. That $321,000 gets invoiced to Crocker on July 1st of the year. They're running, the MLP is running a fiscal year of July 1st to June 30th. We take that number, divide it by 12, divide it by the number of subscribers, and invoice that out to the subscribers. So when a Leverett customer gets a bill, it'll have a Crocker logo on the top of it. There'll be a line item for the Crocker service that they're buying. There'll be a line item for the MLP fee, which is currently $49.95. We collect that money. We remit a check to the town or to the MLP, $27,000, $26,000 and change every month. So the MLP gets that money and then pays their bills with it. I believe the Leverett MLP is about 10 to 15 hours a month worth of administrative overhead, bookkeeping, a little bit of legal. With Leverett, they leverage the existing town entities that would do that, bookkeeping and legal pieces, paid them a little bit extra out of the MLP budget, and covered the operations of the MLP. So our biggest model, and I think the biggest thing where we differ from some of the other options that are out there, is ownership. I very, very strongly believe that if you're paying for it, you should own it. It's your town residents that are voting for it. It's going to end up on your property tax, one way or the other. Ultimately, the town is responsible for paying that bond back. Whether you have zero subscribers or 100% subscribers, the town has to pay it back. So we firmly believe that if you're paying for it, you should own it. Benefits of owning it, you have control. If we're not doing our job, you can kick us out. You can hire another ISP that can come in and do a better job. It keeps us honest. It keeps us competitive. Every 3 years, Leverett's going to release an RFP looking for a new service provider. We have to remain competitive on our pricing model in order to stay and keep that business. So you're not going to be locked into any one service provider. It gives you the opportunity in the future, if there's a lot more competition coming in, to open up the network and allow every service provider to come in and deliver service on that one.
Question about that. So how true is it that you really can, every 3 years, switch or something? Aren't you sort of essentially locked in to a certain extent? It would be a high barrier to change to a different ISP because of the logistics of porting over telephone numbers, moving all the customers, and so on.
You would do it over a period of time. Moving the IP addresses is really kind of trivial. That could be done on a weekend. You know, one night you go to bed with a Crocker customer, and the next morning you wake up and you're ISP XYZ. Moving the phone numbers, there's a little bit more complicated because there's a number porting process that has to go through. Again, that's not all that difficult. The most difficult part of getting the Leverett customers onto the new network was moving the wire inside the house, not moving the number from Verizon to Crocker. Once the wire inside the house is connected to the ONT, which is the fiber box on the outside of the house, reprogramming the ONT to talk to a different phone switch, it's 5 minutes of programming and rebooting the ONT. So it is, from a technical standpoint, really pretty trivial. There's some administrative overhead to move things around, which we would have to work with the new service provider to migrate. Customers would have to establish a new business relationship with the new company. So there is a little bit of inertia in there, but it's not insurmountable. And, you know, looking at from a competitive landscape, if we were gouging the customers and there was a, as I've heard, a 97% profit margin in ISP business, which, by the way, there isn't, that there'd be so much profit that a competitor would just, it's worth their while. They would come in and help facilitate the move.
So do you, is there terms in your existing contract with Leverett that says if you were not to renew, that you have contractual obligations to facilitate a transfer?
Yes. It's a three-year contract with 2 one-year renews. It has a 90-day escape clause for either party. Leverett can cancel it at will with no penalty. And if they do cancel it, we have to help migrate customers over. They have 90 days to migrate the customers over. So it's kind of the way I run my business. Is our contracts are really kind of thin. I think our Leverett contract is 3 pages long, maybe 4 pages. I want customers to use us because I'm better, not because I have a piece of paper that says you have to use me. So we tend to be very flexible with that. And in reality, our capital expense for gaining access to the network is very low. The town is paying the capital expense, millions of dollars to build the network. I already have the infrastructure to get connected. So I'm not going to tie you up with long-term contracts because I don't have a huge amount of money invested in it. So one of the things we look at is single town and regional town ownership. We can work with a single town like we've done with Leverett. Looking at the numbers, Ashfield is as good or better than Leverett from a MLP fee standpoint, from a density standpoint.
Why do you say that? Isn't it houses per road mile or something like that?
Yes, and that's and where we at.
Very different from Leverett? I thought we had twice the road miles per house.
So you have 72 route miles, they have 43.
Right.
You have 1,743 poles, that is about 300 more than they have. They have about 1,400. But you have about 130, 140 more premises than they do. So you've got a potentially larger subscriber base, and that helps mitigate, the larger. The polls leads the number of polls leads directly to a cost item on a spreadsheet. The route miles factors less significantly into insurance and the escrow you have to put aside every month. To meet the requirements of an MLP. The other thing that that mitigates the difference between Leverett and Ashfield is true for all the towns. When you escrow, you have to put aside enough money using best practices to replace the fiber plant in 20 to 30 years. And that's good. It may last longer than that, and that escrow account might continue to build and build. But in Leverett, being ultra conservative, at least from a fiscal perspective, they decided to escrow not only the value of the fiber plant itself, but also the make-ready work. The make-ready work, once you do it and you have your license, as long as you're paying your annual license fee, you have that make-ready license in perpetuity. So most of the towns, and certainly an organization, for example, like Wired West, has decided we don't need to escrow make-ready work because the make-ready work is done and will always be there. So I've adjusted the Ashfield number on the line item for escrowing downward to reflect a third less than all of the things being equal, that which they are doing in Leverett, because they include the make-ready work in their escrow, and you don't have to, and I don't even think it's advisable to do that. So all rolled up, all of the things being as equal as possible, your numbers compare very favorably to Leverett's numbers.
So, Bill, are you... you all are proposing to be the network operator as well. You would like to possibly be, correct?
We can serve that role. Unless an alternative approach develops where we would partner with a network operator, we are prepared to be the network operator, yes.
So the number here, network operator, is what you estimate through your internal guesses about what would
the number that's
cost.
In the budget is based on us being the network operator.
Uh-huh.
So in Leverett, we're their internet service provider. Well, the gas and electric is the network operator. So the role of the network operator is to maintain the fiber physical plant, the fiber on the poles. They do a drive around the route once a month and look for low-hanging trees and that sort of stuff. If a tree comes down and takes the fiber down, Holyoke Gas and Electric will dispatch the repair crew. It is not a Holyoke Gas and Electric truck that shows up to repair it. It's going to be outsourced to a contractor. They also manage the electronics, but we also, as the ISP, also manage the electronics. So there's a little bit of overlap in the roles that we play. So when we merge the two roles together, where we are the network operator, we eliminate some of that overlap. That's why the pricing is a little bit lower.
So yeah, the number you see here for a network operator includes us having more than one bucket truck company truck on retainer. So they will always respond when we need a truck or two. It also includes the cost of the network connection to us, a 1 gigabit connection as there is currently in Leverett, to us to gain access to the internet and to our phone switch. So all that's included in the network operating figure. We should say that these are by no means guaranteed numbers. They're projections based on the Leverett model of what it would look like in Ashfield if Ashfield made virtually identical decisions to Leverett other than escrowing for the make-ready work. And once the network is in your possession, you may opt to do some different things. You may opt to have, for example, Leverett uses the allowed return as a rainy day fund. And not to repay the debt burden. You may, upon hitting 75, 80, 85% subscription rate, say, you know what, we're going to pay another $10 a month to help pay down the debt service. That would still have us well within, you know, the comfortable range of, you know, $90 to $100 all in for phone, internet, and network upkeep, and still be able to pull another $10 per subscriber per month out to help pay down the debt service.
How do they manage that MLP? Do they manage that? Maybe you don't know the answer to this question. Would it be quite similar to the way we operate the sewage treatment plant as an enterprise fund, something that's totally separate from the town?
Yes, totally separate. There's a three-member board. They meet once a week right now, but they're probably going down to once a month. In Leverett, the median increase for the property tax was $208 a year, $17 a month. So if you add up our fees, you're getting a gigabit of internet in Leverett for $92 a month, just over $92 a month, which is significantly less than any other option that we've seen.
You're saying taking the bill plus the $17.
Plus the $17 a median. So Leverett chose to take the capital cost of the bond and spread it over the entire property base because every homeowner benefits by the fiber in the street. Every homeowner is connected to the fiber, whether they're using it or not. It makes the house more valuable. It makes the house easier to sell. So every homeowner benefits from the fiber. Every homeowner pays, and on average, it's $208 for the median house. You can very easily roll that up into the subscriber fee, and instead of having a $50 MLP fee, you have a $67 MLP fee. Actually, it'll be a little bit more than that because it's not 100% of the town. But at some point, you start tipping the scales of what somebody is willing to pay and you may lose your some on your subscriber base. So you may see your subscription go down, your take rate go down, if the burden is too much on the subscriber. And we've
those
heard of towns.
Those decisions we'll have to make when the time comes.
Absolutely, right. And you can make that change on an annual basis. You can make it quarterly. Leverett reviews their MLP fee. In fact, we just went through a review with them. They're doubling the bandwidth into town, and it's supposed to go into effect, I think, next week, the week after next. So they were going from 1 gigabit into town to 2 gigabits into town, and they're not changing the MLP fee at all. So because there was a higher than expected take rate, they had a choice of lowering the MLP fee to the end user or raising the bandwidth, and they decided to raise the bandwidth.
Town of Alford apparently is doing something interesting. Their model, their plan is to have 60% of the debt burden covered by the subscriber base and 40% covered by the tax base. So a heavier percentage shifted onto those that are using the network. Everybody pays a little, but those that are using it pay more on a per invoice basis. Now, obviously, they haven't implemented that yet because they haven't built the network. They're waiting like everybody else for MBI to design and build the network. But they are using Alford. MBI is using Alford, and maybe Eric Nakajima has already mentioned this to you, as kind of a living laboratory on how to craft an agreement between MBI and a town that chooses to go in its own direction. Not advocating that. I think there's a lot of benefit in cooperatives, where each town retains its own individual ownership and ultimate control, but there's sharing of resources and expertise and some expenses.
Did you all talk yet about the cost of the service itself?
Not yet.
But we will.
So in Leverett, there's three packages that a subscriber can purchase. There's internet only, which is a full gigabit of internet. There's voice only, which is a very full featured voice service with unlimited calling to US 48, Canada, Puerto Rico, and some very aggressive international rates. We're like 2.9 cents a minute to most of Europe and China. And then there's a bundle. So the bundle plan is internet and voice. So internet only is $24.95. Voice only is $29.95 today, but January 1st is $24.95. So let's call that $24.95. $50. And the bundle is $39.95. So you get an additional savings on top of that when you buy the bundle.
That's full-time, or is that an introductory offer?
That's full-time. That's it, yes. That's if anything, it'll be going down. I don't expect it going up. Internet rates are always going down. In 7 years or so, when Leverett is going through an electronics refresh and they go from a gigabit to the home to who knows what, 100 gigabit to the home, that's going to be available in 7 years. The price will probably stay the same. I can't guarantee that, but the price for me is always dropping. So the price to the customers. The largest expense actually is there's a lot of labor to getting customers online, especially customers that have never had high-speed internet. There's no wiring in their homes. They don't have their computers set up for it. So there's a lot of online support to get people connected. We're hoping that dies down as people get used to the service. And so those are the three prices, right?
So just to clarify and make sure it's clear, so the three prices that we're talking about would be roughly $17 on the median household, is similar in Nashville to property. If we had a 75% subscription rate, then it would be another approximately $41 per person. Then if they were getting phone and internet, it would be $40 on top of that. So the total cost to the typical subscriber's household would be about $97 for phone and internet, including property tax.
Right. Yeah, so we're under the $100 sweet spot. So I think I've flipped through, I didn't go in order, but I think I flipped through all these slides and covered all the key talking points.
So the key is going to be, David, is just trying to find that spot that makes the most sense as to what is going to be on the property tax and how much is going to be built.
Yeah, although I did a little bit of analysis, could probably dig it out. But when, if we have high enough subscription rates, it's pretty good, I find.
Yeah.
Except for those people who are really have very large expensive properties.
Right, and the, ultimately, it's always going to be more efficient to have the property tax run directly to the town instead of running through me on the MLP fee. Because I'm gonna have credit card expenses for clearing credit cards and that sort of stuff. I have to, in Leverett, I cover the no pay, slow pay customers, so.
Yeah, that was going to be one of my questions. How do we calculate that in?
So we're in Leverett with the MLP fee, it is calculated in. We're responsible for the $321,000 a year to Leverett, whether the customers pay us or not. We will shut customers off if they don't pay. But that's factored in. So if you took the actual MLP fee and divided it by 12 and divided by the number of customers, just 618 customers, it's less than $49.95. It comes into like $45, somewhere around there. We mark it up to $49.95 to cover our no pay, slow pay, cover our 3% credit card clearing, and our 1.5% to generate invoices, that sort of thing. Our goal is to have the MLP fee be budget neutral to us. I don't want to make a profit on it, and I don't want to lose money on it. As long as we're close to budget neutral, that's where we want to be, and that's where we are in Leverett, and that's what we'll do with every town we work with. The profit that we're looking at generating is off of the service that we deliver. And in Leverett, the service that we're delivering is $25. We're running at about 10% profit, so there's about $2.50 a customer that we're making on a $100 invoice. So it's pretty thin. But it's something we're interested in doing, something I think we do pretty well. One of the advantages of using an established ISP is that I already have a network. I already have a significant number of customers in the valley. You know, we're serving customers in Greenfield and Northampton and Amherst and Holyoke and Springfield. So all of that revenue that we're getting from all the bigger towns helps offset the operations of our network. And Ashfield benefits from that because we have a more robust network with more bandwidth available to serve the customers.
There's an economy of scale.
Absolutely. And it's beyond just getting the 44 towns in the unserved region. If that's one thing, but the 44 towns in the unserved region, the revenue generated from that is smaller than the revenue you get out of the Greenfields, Northampton, Amherst, all the bigger towns. So,
in the MLP fee, you spoke briefly about there's a calculation for depreciation in there.
Yes.
Is that controlled by what's allowable, or it's, is it controlled by how long it's going to take them to pay for it, or is it
it's controlled under Mass General Law, Chapter 164. I forget the exact section. There's almost 200 sections. And it says you have to escrow 3% annually of the value, capital value of the asset. So you would determine, and not including 3%
of the capital
annually.
Value.
Yeah.
Annually, right. Not including the electronics. The electronics falls into a different category of more frequent replacement. Every 7 years is best practice. It's the value basically of the fiber that has been strong. So if at the end of the day, MBI comes and says, we spent X amount of capital on building the network in Ashfield, and that amount is $1.2 million, just making that up.
Right.
And so 3% of $1.2 million would be, what, $35,000, something like that?
$36,000.
You would need to escrow $36,000.
But you're representing your estimate here in that first line item of replacement of fiber plant is, what do you think, is that 3%?
Yeah. And what is that number?
You've got about $100,000.
Right, so those numbers come from MBI, and roughly a third of the construction is make-ready work. So you don't have to do that again. So you deduct a third of the total cost to figure out what your capital cost is.
So what's your MBI number?
3.7. Please, the total cost.
3.7. So a third of that would be 2.3?
Two-thirds of it.
2.4. 3% of that would be 60, 70,000. So that's probably the actual number. But we haven't gone so far in depth into this to actually do it on what your projected actual number would be. But clearly, if it were 60, 70,000, that's better than 100,000, and makes your number go down, and your MLP fee go down, and all to the good. Yeah, just in general, there are kind of three tiers of towns. There are those towns that are clearly in great shape. Beckett, Otis, they have 1,800 homes. It's a little bit complicated in maybe some of those towns because of the seasonal nature of some of those homes, but nonetheless. And then you've got your middle tier in the 600 to 850, 900 range, and that's squarely where Leverett fits as well, where it's eminently doable no matter which approach you take. And certainly, individual ownership is doable. And then you've got your lower tier, 600, 500, 400 homes, where the numbers, because of the numbers of subscribers, potential subscribers, it becomes increasingly problematic if a town like Charlemont, for example, they're in the upper end of the lower tier, whereas Ashfield is in the upper end of the middle tier. So, again, all good from an Ashfield perspective.
You mentioned the economies of scale that you all realize by having additional business in the valley. You also mentioned the possibility of a cooperative structure of multiple towns working together, and you suggested that some of the savings we could recognize would be in administrative. My question is there other savings that we could recognize in terms of, in the same way that I think Wired West is imagining construction of the network? And maybe the other way of looking at this is, could we recognize some savings even if towns are not adjacent to each other? Could we share transport costs, for example, if we bought transport to Coleraine or something like that, and then there was a single point of presence there where we bought a gigabyte for serving both of us or whatever.
So MBI is doing a regional design and construction.
Yeah.
Right? So you're going to get the economies of scale from the MBI design construction process that you would get with a Wired West type of a regional design and construction, because Wired West is going to have MBI do the design and construction.
But they talk about how there will be significant savings because there wouldn't be a hut in each.
Well, I know, and that's not true. They're not going to realize those savings because they're going to reduce the huts and increase the fiber miles, and huts are the cheap part, fiber is the expensive part. You want to reduce the fiber miles, and you add huts to reduce that.
Well,
that's pretty standard design. If you look at any fiber-to-the-home deployment, they're putting remote terminals, smaller huts, little concrete pads, and deploying that to reduce the fiber miles, because fiber miles are what kills you in a construction project like that. So MBI is building a design, doing a regional design, doing a regional construction. They're going to buy the fiber en masse. They're going to buy the thousands of miles of fiber. They're going to buy 20,000 ONTs. So they're going to get the economies of scale buying the electronics and buying the fiber. They're going to contract with the construction companies to hang 1,000 miles of fiber instead of 40 miles or 70 miles of fiber. So they're going to have the benefits there. The other point of can you share transport with other towns? Yes, you can. You'd want to look at the logistics of doing that, the technical reasons why you may or may not want to do that, but it's definitely possible. You may want to look at leveraging another town to get more redundancy. So you have your own transport here, but you're going through Conway. Well, Conway's not one of the towns because they're a cable town, but
don't hate us.
But Coleraine or what have you to get another diverse route out of town. So there's a lot of things you can do with that. The operating cost for the MLP is really, the lion's share of it is depreciation. It's setting aside money for an electronics refresh. It's pole licensing fees. It's insurance on those on the fiber. All of that really stays the same. If you take one town or 10 towns, well, 10 towns is 10 times more expensive than one town. There really are no real economies of scale of doing that, because you're going to have the same number of poles, you have the same number of fiber miles. You could save some money on the administrative overhead. One of the things that's been thrown around a little bit is leveraging the Franklin Regional Council of Governments or the other council of governments in the area to help administer that, just like they administer shared electrical inspectors and plumbing inspectors and that sort of stuff. So there's options that towns can look at to help leverage a municipal operations and administration of the MLP, but not sharing ownership of the actual asset. So every MLP still owns their same asset, but they all share resources with the same accountant.
As a business owner that's providing internet service, would we potentially, could you imagine that you would offer a more competitive bid to an aggregation of 5 or 10 towns?
We've already priced our internet service based on an anticipated aggregation of significant number of the 44 towns. Our commitment to all of our customers is that our costs go down, our pricing goes down, and that is evident with a lot of our customers. Chicopee Public Schools, for example, is at $8 a meg right now, and they were at $10 a meg last year, and 5 years ago, I was at $35 a meg. So as my network grows, and as MBI coming into the market, the middle mile, which a lot of people hate the middle mile, but as an internet service provider in the region, it is the best thing that's ever happened to this region, has dramatically reduced the cost of bandwidth in and around the valley. And that's one of the reasons why we've gone from $75 a meg to $35 a meg to $10 a meg to $8, and I think we're out in our current E-rate cycle at about $7 a meg. So as we grow and as our bandwidth pricing drops, that gets passed on to the customers. That said, the $24.95 for a gigabit is an amazing deal. You're paying $75 plus the property tax, $92 in leverage to get a gigabit of bandwidth. You can't get that anywhere in the country. It's better than Google. It's better than anybody else that's doing gigabit to the home. So it's a very aggressive price. It is based on a substantial take rate in all the rest of unserved towns.
Not to pick up for a second on the issue of who gets a hut and who doesn't. And we'll use the example you used of Ashfield and Coleraine. Let's say that the hut is in Coleraine.
Well, maybe better to use Plainfield and Ashfield and Goshen or something, because we're all adjacent.
Okay. Let's use Plainfield. What's the distance between the center of town in Ashfield and the center of town in Plainfield? 10 miles, 8 miles, 12 miles, something like that. So you've got a hut in one town, and fiber runs all the way down 112 or 116 into Ashfield and then gets distributed out. And a mile outside of town, of the center of town in Plainfield, a tree comes down or a truck hits a pole and wipes the fiber up. No one's lost any service in Plainfield, but everybody has lost service in Ashfield. By connecting towns that have a hut to towns that don't have a hut, you're connecting with longer stretches of fiber. And increasing the risk that something could happen to that fiber. Conversely, if you have a hut in each town, which right-thinking network engineer is going to want to put a hut in every town, unless there are compelling reasons not to do so. And whenever I hear the argument, it increases costs to, you know, to put a hut in every town, my response is always, yeah, but how much? Is it by 1% more, 2% more, 5% more? Till you give me the actual number that I'm paying more for, then it's all just talk.
And it's to be determined whether it actually does increase the cost, because
right.
you are going to increase your fiber miles. And if you look, if just from the surface, you look at the electronics, well, you're going to save a bunch of money on electronics. Well, you're not, because all the houses are still the same. You're still going to buy the ONTs for every house. The electronics that go up into the hut are priced per customer, per port. So you, instead of having two huts with 500 customers in each, you have one hut with 1,000. You still have the same cards, because you still need to have enough cards to support 1,000. Those cards get plugged into a chassis. The chassis is bent sheet metal. You pay $3,000 for a chassis and $90,000 for a card. It's the cards that cost the money, and you're going to buy those no matter what. So having two chassis or three chassis or 10 chassis, really in a big scheme of things, doesn't change the cost of construction. You'll have an extra generator, you'll have an extra UPS, you'll probably have an extra alarm system. A lot of towns are looking at possibly hanging the hut, which could, it's a 10 by 10 room, cinder block, on hanging off of an existing building, or maybe even using some space in an existing building so you can save money there. But I've yet to see if the Wired West design as opposed to the MBI design is really going to save the money that Wired West claims it's going to. I don't believe
it. I'm not trying to sound like I'm supporting Wired West here. When I communicated with the MBI, because we wanted to understand whether the $3.7 million was a truly conservative estimate or not, and I got information from an email from the contact, I can't remember her name, who said that some of the reasons why it would cost less would be, one, you wouldn't necessarily put a hut in every town. And she also said the other reasons is you wouldn't connect everybody in the town because that would be wasted capital. And she also said, basically a lot of things that Jim Draw had said, she sent me in an email, and the third one was, that their estimates estimated the cost of connecting everybody, but that you could have your own decisions, like you're only going to connect the first 300 feet or something like that.
Right. In our model, that's whether you go down every driveway, whether you connect every house, whether you connect every subscriber, that's a town decision.
Yeah.
It's not our decision. It's not the MBI's decision. The town gets to make that decision. That decision affects how much it's going to cost to build the network. Leverett chose to build fiber for every parcel in town and to put an ONT on every single house. Some houses have two ONTs for some strange reason. There's one on the barn and there's one on the house. But Leverett built the cost of connecting the entire town to the network, and it was $3.6 million to do that. Now, if you buy a parcel of land and build a house in Leverett, there's fiber on the street for you. It's going to cost you $1,500 to connect that fiber to your house, which includes the electronics on the side of the house. And that's just the cost of building a new house, just like connecting to a sewer line or a gas line or putting a well in. So, kind of lost track of what I was talking about. But the, you know, I think MBI's got all those numbers filled in. The real numbers are going to come when they do the design, when they actually have the surveyors going down every street and every driveway and every pole. And then the MBI is going to come back with more accurate numbers. I think their numbers are pretty accurate, but they're not perfect. And then the town can make those decisions. You know, do we want to go down every single driveway? Or are there 20 driveways that are just racking the cost up? And if we, you know, that's a town decision. In our model, that's a town decision, but the town's taking ownership of it. And one of the things that we'll do, I have 21 years of experience doing this stuff, is work with the towns to help provide some translation service between MBI and the town to help you decipher what they're saying and help make decisions. So that's part of the services that we offer with towns that are working with us.
I've got a couple questions, one for you and one for David.
This allowed return, describe what that means.
In chapter 164, Mass General Law, an MLP has an allowed return of 8% annually, up to 8% annually of the value, again, of the capital asset. You can use that 8% allowed return for anything you want.
And how much is needed for future capital?
That's already built
into
the
That's built into the replacement cost.
Yeah, it's a whole different line item.
So this 8% could go to the general fund, it could go to anything.
Well, so good question.
It could go to zero.
It could go to zero. You could say, we're not going to make any allowed return. What Leverett uses it for is an additional rainy day fund. If they have just a bad run of luck where they have four, five, six incidents, that are under the insurance deductible, which is currently $5,000. So they get three, four, five events in a bad run of luck that come in at $3,500 each, and none of it's covered by insurance. They want to have a little extra tucked away, and they're calling it their rainy day fund.
Okay.
Anything over 8% that is collected as an allowed return, for whatever reason, you get more subscribers than you thought you were going to get in a particular year, and you collect that money, it has to be returned the next year to the subscriber base in the form of a rate reduction. Anything above 8% has to go back in the form of a rate reduction.
Now, the MLP can choose to pay the town general fund. The town cannot demand payment from the MLP.
I understand. David, I've heard, just kicked around a little, maybe at Saturday's meeting from Wired West, that, and I want clarity on this, it's public, so it's just information that's out there, and it doesn't necessarily reflect good on you guys, but there was something said that MBI has a more lucrative situation if they connect to individual towns, like individual silos, as opposed to a cooperative one big entity. Help me with that, because I struggled over that whole concept. I couldn't stay for the whole meeting. I don't know if it was brought back up. Right. That was brought up.
So that was sort of what I was asking about, because essentially what is being discussed is the cost of transport for the individual towns, that is the connection to the internet. If there's, if you have to pay the Axia to connect to the middle mile in every town, then that's been the argument from Wired West, is that's a lot more expensive than if you could have a single point of connection to the internet someplace, maybe only one or two or something like that, to the middle mile or whatever, and that that would be cheaper. And so their suspicion is that the strategy that MBI is encouraging is to have a point of, I guess it's a point of presence in every town or whatever, or a connection to the MBI 123 network in every town that you'd have to pay for. And that would be more money, significantly more revenue is what I understand.
For MBI.
For MBI.
So, for what it's worth, there's no point even talking about it. It's a decision that's already been made at the highest levels. Stan Rosenberg, Steve Kulik, Ben Downing, Paul Mark have all weighed in and said, you're not going to bypass the Mass Broadband 123 network. It's a non-starter. So I'm not sure why Wired West keeps bringing it up, because in MBI's view and in our legislative contingent's view, it's a dead issue. It's already been decided. There's going to be no bypassing of the
I'm not really sure.
Let's not get too far off confusing topics here. I feel like we're getting a little... I'm more interested in what Crocker can do for us than what somebody
right. Well,
else
I mean,
thinks
it is,
they can do.
It is part of the discussion, because part of the MLP operating cost is the network connectivity, the middle mile. So getting this town connected to the middle mile so you can then get to the ISP. Crocker, hopefully, but any ISP. I'm not quite sure what, I mean, obviously you say, well, I'm going to buy two circuits instead of 40. Two's less than 40, it's going to be less money. But those two circuits are going to be much bigger than 40 small circuits. What that savings really amounts to, I don't know. You do reduce your redundancy and reliability because now you're running everything through fewer circuits instead of more. I know that MBI has been very aggressive on pricing. When MBI rolled out their price book 5 years ago, they were definitely the cheapest guys in town, by far. The competition has reacted. As an example, for me to get a circuit from Springfield to Boston 7 years ago was a $21,000 circuit a month. It's now $3,000. And that's because of MBI. MBI was $7,500 for that same circuit. When I didn't buy from MBI and I bought from their competitor, they called me and asked why. And I said, you're twice the money. They come back and agreed to a pricing for $3,000 from Boston to Greenfield. So they are responsive and will react to those competitive pressures to get something done. And I feel confident that even though they're going to be leveraging the middle mile, that's what the middle mile is built for. Specifically what the middle mile is built for is to be able to allow these your towns to connect to the internet at a cost-effective rate. If it's not cost-effective, then they failed their mission.
Thank you. So, what I'm getting is Crocker has a lot of experience as an ISP.
Yes.
How about an operator?
Yes, we've been operating our own network for 21 years. Yes. And we have dark fiber leases we've had in place for a decade. We're running multiple 20 gigabit rings between Springfield and Northampton, Springfield and Greenfield, Verizon central offices in Northampton, Greenfield, Springfield. We're running a very high speed carrier grade network for 20 years. I've rebuilt my network 5 times.
And you've got contractors that are lined up to be the internet operator as far as maintenance?
Yes, we do. We also have, My brother's a master electrician. We have 9 electricians on staff, a garage out of Greenfield. We have vans. In Leverett, we did about a third of the in-house wiring extending from the house. Other local electricians did about a third, and another third did it themselves. So we're gearing up. We have fusion splicers and fiber techs on staff right now. We do mostly in-house work. We don't really do outside plant. We're gearing up for that. We don't have any ambitions of being the general contractor to do the construction, but we can definitely do some of the break, fix, and repair work, and then we'll definitely contract with the Ockers, the Phoenix Communications, and O'Connell's of the world.
Yeah, don't mind telling you, our lead bucket truck company would be Phoenix Communications. They're out of Shrewsbury. They have over 100 trucks, over 100 bucket trucks, scattered around. We would have more than probably 2 or 3 trucks on retainer for them, which means you're guaranteed to get a truck when you, so you pay monthly whether you use it or not, and then it's time and materials, and all that's factored into the network operating costs. We would have a second bucket truck company, probably Ockers. Although we're also talking to like Collins Electric. What's attractive about Collins is that they have a garage in Chicopee, but they also have a garage in Pittsfield. And we've talked with some other folks that I can't really tell you about that represent kind of a unique approach, kind of a public-private partnership approach. So we've got
plenty of contractors out there.
Absolutely,
yes.
And we've already got a well-established subcontractor-contractor relationship with Phoenix. They do excellent work. They were one of the major builders of the broadband 123. They're just top quality, top responsiveness, not the lowest price, but worth it because they show up when they're supposed to.
Would you be interested in either or
as well as both ISP and network administrator? I mean, is it possible that
yes.
you just ended up as the ISP or
yes.
just the network?
Yep.
Right. I mean, ISP is really our bread and butter. That's what we do, and I think we do it very well. The network operator role in there is what you need. You kind of need a network operator, so we can step in and do it. But we're partnered with Holyoke Gas and Electric and Leverett, and it's a great partnership. So I'm sure we can work with any other network operators out there. One of the things that I would recommend that you think about long term is at some point you probably want to open up the network, meaning you want to bring in other ISPs and other competitors. When you do that, you want to have an independent third party as a network operator so that they can keep the warring ISPs apart. And that's kind of the way MBI did it with the middle mile. Axia is a network operator. They're wholesale only, dealing with service providers. Service providers are retail. And the network operator keeps all the ISP's business separate. That's something you might want to think about. Is, you know, you don't need to do that in the beginning, but over time you might want to look at saying, you know, let's see if there's other competitors out there to keep Crocker on.
Well, just open it up to one of them.
Do you have any opinions about an open network model?
Yeah, I think an open network model is great. I think that's what built the internet. I feel that if I can compete in the same ball field, playing the same game, I'm the local guy, I'm going to win enough business to make me happy. I don't need to win all the business. So I welcome competition. It keeps everybody honest.
So just to be clear, the town could have this, make a decision of whether to have an exclusive ISP, which is what we've been talking about. Or we could say we could have multiple ISPs that all would have contracts with the town to meet certain minimum standards or whatever, and they all could compete for business, which is what they do a lot in Europe, but they do almost not at all here in the United States. And the general fear is that if there are many ISPs all competing, then nobody gets particularly good service because it's all small potatoes. Whereas if you've got one committed ISP, you've got consistent service and you've got a much larger number of subscribers for that ISP.
And one of the things that MBI has mentioned that they're willing to do is manage the RFP process. If there's a group of towns of committed and they're at a point where they need to start looking for network operators and ISPs, the towns can do an RFP themselves or work with MBI to get a regional based of RFP process sent through.
That being said, I always like to jump in with this, and Matt knows what I'm going to say. We this past summer submitted our entire suite of MLP fiber to the home municipality services for inclusion on our state contract, ITT 46, and on August 28th, I'll remember that date for a long time, we got our approval notification from OSD Operational Services Division that runs the state contracts that they approved the inclusion of our stuff. So you can actually buy, as a municipality, as an MLP, all of our stuff that we do in Leverett right off a state contract. There's also a section under network operator, it's called ICB, individual case basis, where we can craft a customized network operations approach for each individual town or collection of towns. So, yeah, RFPs are great, but if you take a look at somebody like Crocker, who you see what they're doing in Leverett, you like what you hear and like what you see, and you say, you know, let's shortcut the process and just use state contract. Get the exact same pricing that you would get in Leverett, if not better. So I always have to add that.
And it's all covered by the terms and conditions of the state contract.
So help me out with that for a second, just a pause. That must be under procurement or something. That you're saying you don't necessarily have to go out for an RFP, right?
Correct.
Is that what you're saying?
An MLP doesn't have to go.
What's MLP? Oh,
municipal light. Okay. Doesn't have to go out to bid. Regardless, for services.
For services,
they have to go out to bid for capital items, but they don't have to go out to bid for services. I think either you go out to bid, craft your own terms and conditions that you're comfortable with, or you stay contract because you like their terms and conditions. Everything's month to month. There's no terms. You know, it's terminate for convenience. A lot of good protection in state contracts. So it gives you the option to do either or.
For both network administrator and network because they services. Basically.
Correct.
Correct. Correct. Want to spend just a little bit talking about should you go forward with us, and now we're your ISP, and we're a year or 15 months away from the network being completed, what would you expect from Crocker? What you would expect is, just as we did in Leverett, we appoint a single point of contact from Crocker to the town. And that would be regardless of whether it's an individual town or an individual town as part of a cooperative group of towns. Every town gets their single point of contact. Would you care to venture a guess who your single point of contact would be should you go with Crocker Communications? I hand it off to Jessica Thompson.
So it would be me. If you didn't guess that, it would be me. Again, my name is Jess Thompson. I live in Ashfield on March Road, and my boys go to Sanderson. So I recognize many of your faces because we've hung around together for play dates or at baseball games, et cetera, et cetera. So I would be the person. So as we were signing up folks in Ashfield when there were questions, I would be the person that you would reach out to. When Bill was our single point of contact when we were bringing Leverett on board, so he spent many a Sunday at the transfer station, so I could multitask and bring our recycling and also answer questions. Because I am local and in town, you could also ask me questions when you picked up Sydney after play rehearsal, or perhaps when we go to the Cape this summer. So I am local, I'm here, and would be readily available, whether at the transfer station, stop in the house at March Road. I would probably have one of those driveways you'd have to consider. So you might want to call me from the bottom and have me meet you.
So in Leverett, we were awarded the ISP contract June-ish last year.
Late May. We finalized the contract in July.
Right. And we immediately put our heads together with the, at that time it was a broadband committee. The broadband committee in Leverett has been disbanded and replaced by a three-person MLP committee. We put our heads together and how are we gonna maximize our take rate, because that's key. So one of the things we immediately agreed to do was have a little incentive pre-subscription period. It started August 15th. It ran until October 31st, Halloween Day. If you pre-subscribed with a one-month $49 payment, which would go towards whatever you ordered, you know, for your first month, then that would get you a subsequent free month. So you pre-subscribe. Prepay 1 month to get a second month free of Crocker service. An MLP, by law, is not allowed to give anything away. Everything has to at least break even, if not make money as an MLP. So that got, and we huddled on, okay, you know, transfer station is kind of obvious. Let's do some town meetings, informational town meetings, where we talked and Holyoke Gas and Electric talked to give people an idea about what's coming. Answer questions about long-distance service and things like that. And we really tried to customize it to the town. It's called LeverettNet. Their email accounts, we give five free email accounts per subscriber. Your email addresses would be bill@leverettnet.net. There's a lot of town pride involved in that. We did specific town signage, advertising, you know, the coming of the October 31st deadline. And then on the last day, which was a Friday, the Halloween on the 31st, We left the town hall open until midnight. You could put signs all over the place. You can sign up until midnight. And we got 65 people on that last day, which represented at that point 10% of all pre-subscriptions. We had about six. It represents 10% of current pre-subscription rate. But since we were only at about 70%, then it was actually about 14-15% all on that last day. So we do things like that that make it personalized and customized for the town. And again, we would do that regardless of whether it's an individual town that's going it alone or a town that's part of a 7, 8, 10, 15, 20 town cooperative. We're still going to want to encourage that individualized approach, that town approach, personalize it, and identify and work with the key people around town that know everybody.
Bill, I'm trying to get my head wrapped around one thing here. You said July, August is when you hammered out your contract.
Of last year.
Okay. So here they go, they're building out their poles and everything.
Yeah.
2 years ago, 3 years ago, help me understand when they formalized the contract with you with respect to when they did
so they formalized the contract with us the summer of 2014.
And that was how long after they started
about a year, year and a half after they started working with Matrix Millennium for construction.
And did it take a year and a half to get through their contract with you?
Or? No, they did an RFP in the spring and awarded the contract in June, and we signed it in July.
So they went a year without really knowing who was
correct.
Correct.
Do what?
Correct.
Both for ISP and network.
They had Holyoke Gas and Electric on board at the very early stages because Holyoke Gas and Electric was operating
as the project manager to manage
the contractor. You don't have to do that because MBI is doing that.
Okay, I just needed to know that because you're talking about all that. And Jess, how long have you been with Crocker, if I can ask?
Sure. I've been. It was 10 years in September. I've been with Crocker for quite a while. And I've lived on March Road since 2003, but I'm a Hilltown girl. I actually graduated high school with Tom. I went to Mohawk. I grew up in Shelburne.
Okay, good, thanks.
I'm a city boy. I grew up in Holyoke.
Yeah, I'm over.
We like them anyway.
I grew up in Greenfield. That's a city now, too.
At some point, are we going to get something a little bit more formal from you guys? Do we have to invite?
So the next steps, yeah, we can definitely continue discussions. The next steps is really choosing MBI. You don't have to choose us yet. So MBI has a letter of intent that they're looking to get towns to sign, and that is basically that you're going to be agreeing to the MBI design build process and start that ball rolling.
So we almost sent that. Mm-hmm. We decided to hold
on.
So you want to talk to MBI, talk to Eric Nakajima, and get that stuff straightened out and push forward. And that'll get you in line with the other towns that have done the letter of intent to continue down the design and construction phase. Design construction is going to be 2.5-3 years or so. So if you want us on board to help you with some translating service and technical expertise to help translate what MBI is telling you, you're going to want to bring us on board earlier. But you really don't need us on board for another year and a half or so just to get things going. We started our pre-sale subscription in August with the expectation the network was going to have green lights in December. I think December 17th was the date when the contractor was supposed to be substantially complete and we can start putting customers on. They didn't make that time frame. We actually started getting customers in late April, early May. The contractor would do a street and hand over 5 or 10 a week in the early stages. And then when they started getting really going, they were doing 50 to 60 a week. So it was about 10 or 12 week process before they got the network completed. And they were handing over, every week we get a list of here's all the streets and houses that are complete. We get the list on Friday. We'd reach out to all the customers that following week and get them on the internet as fast as possible. We didn't touch voice until the contractor was out of the network. Just from a reliability standpoint, 911, we don't want to get customers on the network until we know the network is stable. So we didn't start really putting customers and porting voiceover until late August. And as Bill said, we're mostly done. There's a few stragglers. We had to get some more letters of authorization from the customers, and just the paperwork trail is kind of taking a little bit longer than we'd expect. But that's the timeline. So it's really been about a year and a half until now.
The most exciting part was calling people and saying, guess what? You get to turn on your fast internet, because they had a very similar experience to many of us in Ashfield, where we're relying on our cell phones or perhaps dial-up or satellite, and instead of it just being something that's easy, it's something that presents a lot of frustration. So our team member who was making those calls was like, I feel like I'm Santa Claus every day.
The last six business days, last week and this week, we've gotten three new subscribers, all of whom just bought new homes in Leverett. I had a woman reach out to me yesterday and say, we're moving in, we just moved in, I wanna know how to get internet. I said, did the previous owner have service? She said, yes. So, I'm gonna send you an application, fill it out, send it back. She sent it back about 2 hours later, and an hour later we had her turned on, and she had her router plugged in and she had internet. So within less than 24 hours of her first reaching out, she was up and running and thrilled to death that she's got fast internet in her new home. So, I mentioned that for a couple of reasons. It's really quick and easy to get people started. Voice takes a little bit longer because you have to do the whole non-reporting thing. That takes a week or 10 days. But the internet is easy and quick. And I also mention it because three new homes in Leverett got bought and sold in the last week. You definitely see the pickup in real estate transactions in Leverett.
The multi-family homes that would be two hookups, two
boxes,
and
yeah. There are 20 to 25 two-family homes, and each of those has an ONT on either side.
Yeah, you can do an ONT each. So the ONT has two phone lines and two internet connections on it. So one ONT could serve two multifamilies. But you can also get a multi-tenant ONT that'll have eight internets and eight phones. It's just a different part number from the vendor. So with a little bit of planning, if you know there's a larger multifamily, a four unit or something like that, you can put one ONT that'll serve the whole building, or you can put four individual ONTs.
You guys going to be at the meeting on the 14th?
Yes.
Wouldn't miss it.
We'll be in the audience for sure. I don't think they're going to allow us to stand up and talk, but we'll be there.
Why not? Matt, you talked about the prospect of if after 3 years, let's say, a town chose to go with another service provider, that's something you would expect, that there's competition and so on. What would the other competitors be that the town might look to?
Well, we're really the biggest little guy left. There are some smaller ISPs that are still operating in the valley. I know you have one here.
That's Hilltown?
Yeah, Hilltown, what's it?
Chris is here.
Oh, there is.
Hey, Chris.
And then
we're talking about you, Chris.
Then there's Cornerstone, which is a phone company and ISP up in upstate New York that's also operating out of Richmond, Mass. There's OTT, which is Granby Telephone, but they're operating out of Maine. There's a couple other providers. DSCI is a large ISP phone company out of New Hampshire. They, as far as I know, they don't do residential, but that could change. You know, if there's 20,000 residential customers available in the region, they may change their model.
Would Holyoke Gas and Electric be a candidate for that sort of thing?
Potentially, yeah. I'm not sure if they're looking at expanding outside of Holyoke or not, but that's a question you can ask them.
Yeah. Axia
right now is a wholesale only provider. They do retail up in Canada, and they've talked about the possibility of they can't, the Axia that exists today cannot sell retail. That's part of the MBI middle mile agreement. But they're looking at starting a new Axia company that would be the retail arm to do residential.
They would have to buy service from Axia, the wholesale company, just like anybody else would at the same price structure. They, and they're not a phone company, and they have no plans to become a phone company. They're not a phone company up in Calgary. They talked about being the ISP and then having an open network for any phone company that wants to connect. I know them pretty well. I used to work for them. Most of the folks have changed since I left 2 years ago. I characterize their approach to fiber to the home down here in Massachusetts as erratic. And sometimes they seem interested, and other times they don't seem interested at all.
How about matrix design? Are they in any way a candidate for that sort of thing?
I know that they've offered it as, I don't know what their qualifications are.
I think it would be their first.
Pardon?
I think it would be their first.
Oh. You don't mention video services at all. That's not part of your package, is it? I mean, it's internet and it's...
It's not.
Why would that?
So traditional video service is a dead end. It's a complete waste of money. Massive capital investment to get the encoders and the middleware pieces and the set-top boxes. Very significant operational costs. It's also dying. The traditional cable, I know I cut the cord this summer. I don't have a Comcast circuit anymore. I have an antenna on my roof and a Roku box. That's what people in Leverett are doing. So the industry trend is to do what's called OTT, over the top, and that's Netflix and Hulu and Amazon Prime and Sling. There's a dozen of them out there today, and 3 years from now there'll probably be 100 of them. So that's the industry trend, is that your traditional stuff is dying on the vine and it's being replaced with the over the tops. So spending many millions of dollars to be able to get into a 3-year window, this does not make any financial sense. I looked into it with Leverett because they have a great fiber network, and overlaying TV on top of the network from a technical standpoint would be a pretty fun project. I am a geek at heart. I called WWLP as my first example of being able to get retransmission rights.
Right.
So when you have cable, there's two problems, well, two big problems. One of them is gaining access to the content. And WWLP is pretty easy because they're in Chicopee. And you get NBC content that way. But then you have to have retransmission rights. You have to get a license to be able to retransmit that content to your customer base. And the way the model is structured is you pay per month, per home passed, whether they buy service or not. And I never got a true price out of them. It was in between $1 and $2 a home. And that's just for that one channel. Now you start looking at a 30 or 40 channel lineup, and you can very quickly see that the monthly costs start very rapidly increasing. The other thing, as a small cable provider, you're going to be buying your content from a thing called HITS, which is Head End in the Sky. They're an aggregator of small rural cable companies. They're owned by Comcast. So no matter how you slice it, Comcast is going to win that battle. It just wasn't worth fighting. So that's why we don't do video, and we have no plans to do it.
So a subscriber would, in a sense, be buying services in your model that would include internet and phone services, and would need independently to figure out a way to get TV. Is that right?
Correct. Yeah, they can
satellite or something like that.
They can stay on their satellite.
Yeah.
They can buy a smart TV. Almost every smart TV is going to work with Hulu and Amazon Prime and Netflix. Mm-hmm. You know, Amazon Prime, and don't quote me on these numbers, but I believe Amazon Prime is $100 a year, and there's a ton of video content on that. Netflix is $7.99 a month, and Hulu is in the same price point. It's either $6 or $9. There's another company out there called Sling, which is owned by Dish, I believe, which is $20 a month. HBO, which one of the only reasons why you get cable is to get HBO. You can now do that over the top with HBO Now and HBO Go. That's $15 a month. So the customers, you know, one of the things a lot of people say is they want to be able to a la carte their channels.
Yeah.
You can do that with the internet. You can't do that with traditional cable. So, you know, you can buy exactly the features that you want. Personally, I have Sling, Netflix, Hulu, and Amazon Prime. And I get almost all the content that I want. I also have an antenna in my attic, because my wife wouldn't let me put it outside because it's ugly, that gets the five major channels, NBC, ABC, CBS.
Network types.
The network ones, yes. Right. So I watch Patriots games live on Fox. I watch them long, lose, but...
Infrequently.
Don't talk about
that.
So yeah, so video is there, and we're kind of the new age video of doing it over the internet. And bandwidth is the cure of all evils for that sort of stuff. And throwing a gigabit at a house is, things work really, really well. Really well.
Should we be thinking of 2 gigabits?
You know,
Leverett is moving in that direction already.
So Leverett is peaking at 500 megabits a second. That's their, you know, their 8 o'clock in the afternoon peak is, and it's just a real short little spike for about 15 or 20 minutes. They don't need the second gig right now. They have a feeling that there's going to be a significant number of smart TVs under Christmas trees this year, so they're trying to get ahead of that. And they want to continue to provide an amazing experience for the end user. So I personally think it's probably 6 months early on the need for getting 2 gigs. But that's just right now what they're doing is they're actually getting 10 gigs. So they're migrating, their connection to the middle mile is going to go to 10 gigs. And they're just buying 2 gigs on it. So it's just like a little rheostat. And they can call up Axia and go to 3 gigs and with the... You know, usually a couple of days is what Axia takes to turn around that type of order or so.
But the point there is their decision, they're in control, they can do what they want. We were able to work it. You know, Matt said a little earlier that there's a little bit of a cushion at the top of that $49.95. And they could have said, okay, let's drop the MLP fee down to $46.50 or $47, but instead they opted to keep it at $49.95 and buy a second gigabit to be even that far ahead of the curve. But it was their decision. No one told them to do it. They talked about it amongst themselves. They asked for our advice. We told them you don't need it yet. They decided, well, this is the time to do it. This is, right now is the best time to do it. So they pulled the trigger.
Anybody that hasn't asked a question yet, I think, and we're closing in on 9 o'clock here on a Monday night.
So why don't we finish up?
I've got a lot of great information tonight. I really appreciate you coming in.
Thanks for having us.
For somebody that didn't have a real deep understanding, every week I seem to be understanding more. So
there's a lot to understand. It's a big question. To answer a major question with lots of little questions that you have to figure out as you go along. We're lucky to have people like David in town to.
And it's a massive investment for the town. And we fully recognize how big this is. And that's why ownership is one of the cornerstones of our message, is that the towns retain it. And more than happy to come up and answer any questions at any time. You know, I'm a half an hour down the street in Hatfield, so I'm more than happy to drive back up.
The parting message is, you guys are in really good shape. You know, you're at the high end of that middle tier, where the numbers just make good sense for the town.
Yep, get that letter of intent signed.
Thank you for your time. We appreciate
very
it.
Good. Thank you.
Thank appreciate you. It.
All right. You're not the last thing. Tech committee's got a recommendation for some support.
Yes.
For the town.
Mr. Moderator, I want to table this actually until maybe next week because we did make a recommendation as a committee. It's taken as much on in the moment of life, but we evaluated a bunch of IT firms, brought them in, they did some assessments. We had a company come in to do an IT assessment, to figure out what our needs were. We then talked with a bunch of different providers. Anyway, but Juliet pulled that whole package together, and she's in California taking care of her mom. So, but what we wanted to do was just present you with the rationale that went behind our recommendation to get your approval to go ahead and sign them up.
Well, you're certainly aware, as the rest of us, that we're in need of some help.
Absolutely. Yeah, but I don't actually, now I said we should table it to your next meeting, but next Monday is this MBI meeting, right?
But it's early, right? Are we going to cancel it?
No, MBI meeting's in Greenfield.
Right. But it's early, it's like 5 or 5:30, I believe, isn't it?
It's 7.
I think it's at 7.
We won't have a select board.
5 to 7, yeah.
Oh, 5 to 7.
Oh, it's 5 to 7?
Yeah, it starts at 5.
I see. Well, your call, if you're going to have a select board meeting.
Work for 6. Huh? I don't know.
Anyway, if you want to put it on your agenda, I'll try to, Juliet and I will try to get here.
I'm really thinking that next week that we're going to meet in Greenfield.
Yeah.
And not have a meeting here, which all means that we'll just have to either stop earlier in the day or over the weekend to sign the warrant.
Right.
All right.
Yep.
Okay.
And then I may have to make a decision.
We got to find her. Have to find her own.
Things come up. I'm going to hold the right to call a meeting later in the week.
Yeah.
If we have a number of things that need to be taken care of beyond that. Monday.
Well, perhaps we could, if it's 5 to 7, perhaps we could find a room to just go another half hour.
I don't know.
Okay.
You don't want to get tied up before we stop.
Okay. Yeah.
So we may be looking at a meeting on Wednesday. We'll just have to see what piles up for us.
We got a bunch of stuff that we, a USDA grant info session is down in Greenfield.
That's
on Wednesday.
Oh, Wednesday.
16th. That's the same day as the Mohawk budget meeting.
Yeah, which I'm going to.
Okay. And then I got some other personal stuff, but it's neither here nor there.
Yeah, Wednesday.
We'll figure it out. But we'll take it.
Okay.
And let you know.
Thank you.
Oh, Western maintenance.
Right. There was some discussion. Juliet actually was also the key person here to talk with folks in the town, because she's the one who's responsible for our website. But one of the things that came up is that.
Sound like you're throwing her under the bus a little bit there.
I tell you. But it's nice to have her help out, for sure. One of the things that came up is that our website sometimes is out of date. And there's nobody who actually sort of owns it in the sense of ownership, making sure everything is up to date. If somebody sees that there's something going on, that something needs to be adjusted, they send an email to Charlie and the tech committee, and either Charlie does it or I do it, and it's really no big, or Juliet does it or whatever, it's no big deal. So we can adjust the names of people who are on a committee or whatever, but nobody is maintaining it. So one of the recommendations that came up was that maybe that should be part of somebody's job. And we're just coming back to you to say, that sounded like a good idea to us, that if you wanted to suggest that, to add that to maybe somebody's job description, is to spend a small amount of time.
On the agenda it says maintenance by town clerk. Did you discuss it with the town clerk?
Yes and no. So it came up as a suggestion that she would be interested in doing, but she did not formally request us to say anything, so, she didn't formally make a request to take that job, I hadn't discussed it with you all, so I think it's better just to say...
Oh, she requested.
She said that she would be willing to do it. Right?
Yeah. Oh, so she must have been opening the door for me today when she said, nobody's really discussed it with me.
Right.
And I just didn't step through, so...
Your call.
I'm not really good.
Your call, but I understand that the counselor would be willing to take some of that time.
That's right.
But in my opinion, I don't think it would be something that would be more than an hour or a week of work. But that's worth some discussion, perhaps, with whoever might be doing this.
What kind of qualifications are you looking for to do that?
I don't think it, as long as you can use a computer and follows, and we could do some training in terms, because
no programming,
no programming. None of this would be programming. This would be using websites, and that you need to go through this pull down menu and choose this and database query sort of thing. Just through a web interface, nothing sophisticated. So I think that Anne would qualify.
We can have that discussion. We've got time to do that. I mean, we're limping along now. Are you talking about updating the website, the way the website looks or tastes or anything like that?
Just keeping it current.
Keeping it current. We're also talking about having Charlie make some modifications to make it easier for us to make, for somebody to make some more substantial modifications. That, in other words, you know, if you want to add a new menu item on the left-hand side or something like that, you'd have to go to Charlie right now to do that. But there might be ways that we can streamline that, so even somebody in Town Hall could do that as well. But basically, it's just things like adding these attachments to this web page, updating the names of the people on a particular committee, and that sort of thing.
So, curiosity, what's it built on?
What's that?
What is it built on?
Joomla.
Joomla?
Yeah.
Joomla.
All right, we can take that under advisement, try to come up with something together, wait for Juliet to get back.
We're helpless.
And what's Andy Smith? Andy Smith's be in trouble?
He no. is.
Trouble.
Andy,
I'm the alternate member of the Water and Rest for Ashfield, and I'm feeling now like it's time probably for my replacement to step in and take over. Someone with perhaps a little more political savvy and a little more clout than I'm here. So we're getting to a point in this whole process where I think it's really key to get a couple of strong representatives from Ashfield in there. I think I've been a great placeholder for the last couple of years or more, but I think it's time to get a replacement for me.
So that raises the, so maybe we might not even want to address this right now because we don't even know if we're, don't know what's going to happen with Wired West, but I think Andy does raise a good point to consider, and that is that if we're going to continue with Wired West, we want to think a little bit, we want to revisit who our delegates are, whether it's me or others, whether we've got a representative from our select board or something like that that's one of the delegates, so that person stays up to date or whatever.
I was afraid that's what Andy meant when he said political squad.
I think that's what he might be alluding to. I mean, I think it would be helpful to have somebody who's a little more in the loop that's a town leader. So that's the discussion.
Well, what's our feeling? I didn't get to any Saturday meeting and on this MBI letter. I mean, I've read the letter and I've read a couple of the responses.
Yeah.
And I'm very uncomfortable about the whole thing.
Yeah.
My tendency is when I see a funnel cloud to run away from it.
Bit of a busy battery now, so but I think that things will cool off in a while. But
how things have changed in a year. I can remember going to meetings a year ago where everybody was hugging each other and nuzzling and kissing, and Wired West and MBI were just wonderful together.
Right.
And it's a 180 degree opposite.
It almost made you blush a year
ago. I did. It was. I was embarrassed for them. And how things have changed.
Indeed. So, yeah, I mean, I don't know if we can, I would like to talk a little bit about this MBI.
It's next on the agenda. Let's do it.
So, right, so right now we're in an unfortunate situation in it because it delays, because the MBI sent this letter out, I think it naturally will delay our own process as a town to decide what we want to do. It certainly delays Wired West and the MDI moving forward as well. The key, cutting through a lot of the rhetoric here, it is possible that maybe the MDI is concerned about its revenue stream if Wired West model prevailed.
Can you expand on that statement?
Yeah, but you know, it was interesting.
What is their revenue stream? I thought they were giving money away, not taking it.
Yeah, but they own the middle mile.
Right.
And
everybody has to connect to it.
Everybody has to connect to it and pay for access to it, which
right.
goes back to MBI.
So why do they care how?
Because if there's a connection, if there's a gigabit connection in every town, then they're getting a lot more money instead of there being, say, a 10 gigabit connection for 30 towns. That's in one location.
Mm. They're designing it.
But that's the issue. So Wired West is, you know, their part of their position is we want this regionalized, we want you to build what we call a regional network, which is an optimized network with a minimum number of huts, with redundancy between towns that makes sense, with, you know, the people over on, you know, on the end of, in Plainfield that come off of John Ford Road serve from Ashfield, and the people from, you know, that are on 112 serve from Goshen or whatever, and all of that makes sense. And we don't, that's what Wired West is arguing, that we, so what they call a true regional model.
Mm.
And part of that, and there's a lot of trying to minimize expenses through minimizing connections. For example, one of the things is minimizing connections.
So instead of 30 towns buying connections, Wired West is going to buy a connection.
A connection, and maybe not even from MBI. That's what they would like to do. So that's where I think one of the conflicts is going on here.
Well, the language on some of the responses, I can see that there's as much emotion as there is probably practicality applied.
That's right.
And that's what bothers me the most.
Yes, because there's a lot of bad blood between the two organizations that seem to be more related to politics and control and power issues and so on. Some of this, which we're familiar with, you know, when we think about state organizations and an interest in us, you know, having some self-determination and the feelings that, you know, locally we know what our best interests are and we'd like to make those decisions ourselves and feeling like the state is dictating those to us. So that creates a lot of that tension.
You know, I will tell you that I went to the meeting on Saturday along with a bunch of people in this room. And if you sanitize that whole MBI letter, just take the names out of it and everything, I know a lot more today after listening to Crocker and going to that Saturday meeting than I did before. Mm-hmm. So I've been around the block on this thing, and I'm real keen on going to the 14th and understanding even more, because you can kind of get into this drowsy state of mind where you're going down a path and it might not necessarily be the right path. Mm-hmm. And this concept of owning the asset, there is merit to that. There really is. How we get there, and I'll be honest with you, I haven't seen a lot of interest on Wired West's sort of side about how do we satisfy that requirement and still build a cooperative model? So this is, at the end of the day, I think I'm going to appreciate having been pushed through this thing in different directions, even with all the emotion, which I don't deal with very well either. I just want to make the right decision for this town. So it's been a rewarding experience, even though I wouldn't want to repeat it.
It's interesting that you say that, because Ted and I also share a similar thought that my read on the conflict fundamentally comes down to the MBI's objection to this ownership issue. And I think they may believe that they have the best interest of the town by and say that this is too risky. They may just recognize that there are just basic balance sheet issues or whatever that should be sorted out. I'm not sure, but in any case, right now the tensions are too great that Wired West is not in a position to sort of discuss. Doesn't seem like the organization is in a position to discuss a negotiating point about how one could adjust the ownership scheme to satisfy the MBI. But I think that at some point we'll either get to a point where the legislators are going to be sitting down with the MBI and Wired West, and they're going to say the owner, you know, they're going to, somebody's going to come down on some side or the other and either force Wired West to capitulate, or the MBI is going to have to change its policy. But I think that's really fundamentally what the issue is. And I think it's sort of ironic, because I think a lot of the towns, like us, have not seen this as a huge stumbling block, because I'm only speaking for myself and my understanding of this, but you know, if we own the network in proportion to our capital investment, then we essentially own it to my satisfaction, and I don't particularly want the burden of necessarily owning all of those assets and having to deal with them. And so I feel okay with that, you know, and it's just, you know, it's just moving things around a little
bit. Well, I think it's just dumb luck or good guidance, probably the latter, that when we voted to borrow the $2.4 million, that we didn't put in there that it was Wired West, right? There was language that said that. We would have tripped over that for 6 months. But just to say that we were going to come up with a broadband solution.
Yeah. And just to be clear, you know, the politics have been fomenting between them for a long time, because the MBI put out a Warren article recommendation that was exactly the one that the lawyers had worked out that Wired West recommended, except it struck out, and you're required to work with the municipal cooperative to do it. So this tension between the organizations.
I think a town that voted that right now
is in a more difficult situation.
They're in quite a difficult situation.
Yeah.
The thing that strikes me is that regardless of what ultimately happens, towns like Beckett and Otis and Ashfield, we're going to be able to go forward no matter what.
Right.
You look at those lower tier towns, if they go with a single town solution, they're in big trouble.
They won't be able to do it.
Exactly. So, you know, when you're thinking about the whole cooperative model in terms of social justice and the big towns helping out the little towns, that's what that was all about, really. And if they're pushing us in the opposite direction, there are going to be towns that lose out completely.
Right.
And it seems curious that a state agency that's supposed to be getting the last 10 feet to every house in the state is guiding us away from that.
I agree. So it'll be very interesting to see what their proposal is next Monday. And if it's just the levered model, then you're absolutely right. It's going to potentially be devastating for some towns. And in any case, it probably will result in us paying more as well. But not too much more that we would say no to this, but you know, you've got the numbers. We're talking about something between $90 and $100 instead of $75.
I mean, we could still regionalize with a big town.
towns, big towns, you know.
But it was interesting to talk with them, because it doesn't sound like we would necessarily be saving a whole lot of money.
No, with a hut in every town anyway.
Right, and most of the savings, they said, would just be in sharing an administrative person or something like that, so.
Not big money.
I thought that was interesting to hear their opinion about that.
This allowed return, I thought was interesting, is that there was a legislative maximum, and that doesn't really add up to a whole lot.
It doesn't. In fact, I did a...
Well, 8% of 2.4 million is 192,000.
Yeah, I did a...
Do that a half a dozen times, it's a lot of money at my house.
I did a chart, though, that looked at the total cost to a subscriber. If you offset up to if you offset the tax at the maximum possible return of 8%, and how that would affect your rates. It's when you get up into the 75, you can't, don't worry about it, just let me wave my arms. When you get up to the very high take rates here, the difference is this band of numbers, the difference is just a few dollars one way or the other per month. In the different methods, because there's so many people that are taking service that you're almost paying the same thing in taxes than if you would if you took 8% and applied it to the capital, right? It's just you're robbing Peter to pay Paul, sort of thing. Well, it's going to wash out because almost everybody is a subscriber.
But the difference is, when you get back to this idea of social justice, you know, you do have large property owners and small property owners, and would they be handling it? A larger portion of the burden, with it being on the tax rate? Well, the answer is, of course they would. Sure. So there's probably a sweet spot in there. And it was kind of funny that I think Bill was talking about Alford.
Yeah.
And that 60-40, and that's exactly what I was thinking about. Mm-hmm. Is 60-40, 50-50, somewhere in there.
Tell me,
but that 8% allowable, if it's 192,000, that would pretty much...
Where do you get 192,000 from?
It's 8% allowable capital of the total capital, which would be 2.4.
And it may be, even though 8% you're allowed to take off the top as profit, you may be able to take more if it's paying off debt, for example. Because I know that Wired West was expecting to reimburse the towns.
Yeah, I was trying to figure out how they're going to do that.
If Wired West could only charge 8% more than their costs,
right,
then they wouldn't be able to pay out the towns.
My
understanding is that 8% does not apply to that sort of situation where you're dealing with debt repayment.
Well, remember, if you factor in some depreciation, that's a non-cash expense that you can apply to.
Yeah.
I have a question for our Wired West representative. Why did they go to the LLC model as opposed to a pure co-op? It had to be some legal reason, right?
Yeah, I didn't sit on the governance committee, but I can tell you that the previous pure co-op didn't actually have ownership. And so the LLC provides a mechanism for proportional ownership by the towns, which didn't exist before. I believe that's the primary reason. I do think that, for what it's worth, again, talking about the West and MBI disagreements, MBI has expressed also some concerns about the business plan. And in my personal opinion, I feel like those probably would not have risen to the level of a complaint from the MBI that would have cut off funding preemptively before a proposal was even made, if there weren't these governance issues that they objected to. I feel like their concerns about the business plan are ones that that can be worked out through the comparison of different consultants' reviews and so on. And I don't think that's the major issue.
Didn't you garner that out of the letter, is that those things could be addressed? MBI said those things could be addressed. I didn't feel, reading that letter, it was probably a very difficult letter to read. I'm glad I wasn't in Eric's shoes on that, but if it needed to be written, it didn't, to me it didn't
didn't slam the door on anything. It just said, we've got issues, let's take care of them, we need to address these.
But you have to, ask why it happened the way it did, because Wirewest Executive Committee representatives have been meeting weekly with the NBI to discuss all sorts of things about network design strategies that, you know, Crocker claims is fixed and they're not even moving at all, and yet there's been months and months of discussions about how to optimally design a network. They've shared the operating agreement with them and so on. And when we went to the workshop for the governance for the operating agreement, they had their legal person there who spoke conciliatorily about, yes, there's some point of contention here, but this is something that we can work with the legislators on, this is something that we can take to the MBI board. If all of these towns really want to own their asset, then that would have a significant weight in how we address this and so on. But what happened was the NBI called a meeting with two of the executive committee members, sent the letter to them 15 minutes before the phone call, and said, we're going to be releasing this as soon as we get off the phone. So it makes me think that they're not, even though they say in the letter, they're still leaving the door open that we can work these things out, that they certainly are approaching this in a fairly combative way.
Aggressive. I mean, they could have worked the things out before the letter came out.
It's exactly
so it didn't need to become...
They could have.
Could have
got a sense of the meeting, but I think Wirewest felt betrayed multiple times. In terms of Wirewest felt that way, that insofar as dealing with MBI over a number of months and a variety of these meetings, that their interpretation was one of betrayal on the part of MBI, that they had certain agreements, they had understandings, that we'd get to look at the draft, that they'd have some inputs, and then these things just got issued. And I think that's what kind of generated a lot of the heat in the meeting. So there probably were some rather intemperate things. I didn't see the letter, obviously, that you talked about from Wirewest, I guess, in response to MBI.
But
I think that's one of the real issues here. There's a real political agenda that's being played out here, which is aside from a lot of the merits of the situation.
Well, and I wonder if some of it isn't. Remember a year ago? He said, oh, don't worry about getting the money, that the money's going to be there. Well, here we are a year into a new administration, and I wonder if the Department of Administration and Finance isn't looking at $45 million a little differently than the last administration.
To that point, I don't think that there's a particular concern. My understanding is that most of the money has been transferred to the MBI already. And the governor has said that he's strongly behind the initiative. So I'm not sure if that's the main political issue. So I drafted a letter that I want to share with you all because I'm concerned about the MBI's, the way that even, you know, I'm still pleased, I remain completely open to other options, but I feel that the MBI seems to be taking, trying to strong arm the situation, or trying to really dictate to the towns here what's in our best interests.
Administering the golden rule. Who has the golden makes the rules, right?
So, I think that it would be good for the towns to communicate to Eric that we don't particularly like the way that they're going about doing this, and that they could have worked on this issue differently, and if they're, and that we don't want just a dog and pony show on Monday to say this is how you're going to do things, but we would like to know, instead of sending out a letter with accusations and no basis, no explanation behind their claims, it would have been good to have got detailed reasons why they were compl- complaining about certain issues. And also, it would have been good to have received information about what they proposed instead of just saying, come to a meeting and we will tell you, we will tell you how to proceed.
My thoughts exactly, but I hate when people come to me with problems without, and don't provide a solution. And that's exactly what MBI did here. They threw down this letter that listed a bunch of things that they didn't like, instead of working with MBI to come up with a way that it would work.
Right. With WireWest.
We didn't have to be involved in any of that process. We didn't even have to know that it happened until the final agreement came out.
Right. But to their credit, I think the purpose of that letter was don't sign the operating agreement. And I got that message loud and clear.
Yeah.
And so your point, which you just mentioned, I would say that right to their face next Monday. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, that's where that belongs, is right, is saying, isn't there a better way to get, catch our attention than slamming WireWest the way you did?
Yeah.
So they got my attention. I mean, I get tons and tons of emails, and that one, I understood, don't sign it. That's what they're based, we're not accepting that operating agreement, basically, what they said.
I feel like it could have been done better.
Oh, of course it could.
It could have been done better.
So, I would like to, maybe you could indulge me by, I could read this and we could consider, I'd like to suggest that those who agree with it could sign it and send it, or do you not want to do that, Mr. Chairman?
Well, I don't think we need to read it out loud. I mean, as far as the select board, we all have a copy of it.
Oh, okay.
But, I don't... My personal opinion is that I don't see any reason of writing this and having them get it about the same time that they're going to have the meeting in Greenfield.
Well, I figure I can send it tomorrow and we can basically say, look, we want more information well in advance of the meeting. Which is one of the key points that I take here is provide us some information so we're not just being dictated to on Monday.
The woman on Saturday suggested that her tech committee write the letter and CC their reps and their select board.
Right.
I mean, you could do that almost with your eyes closed without even getting this board involved.
We could, but since we're here, mm-hmm. I thought one option would be that the committees wouldn't have to vote to sign it as committees. Those on the finance committee, select board, and tech committees could choose to sign it if they wanted to. It was just a thought that I had, since we had the benefit of having this joint meeting. Otherwise, the tech committee could convene afterwards briefly and we could just sign it to ourselves. Do you guys have a copy?
I haven't seen it.
But I was at the Saturday meeting and heard all that. So
I know. I'm not particularly interested in signing it myself, but you guys are interested.
I
think we need to let the discussion play out at some level. I mean, when we started this process nearly a year ago, everybody was really fixed on WireWest. And I don't have, without seeing the finalized agreement with WireWest, I can't say that I'm for or against it, but certainly the approach that we've taken here in Ashfield, talking to everyone else, has certainly, I think, opened everybody's eyes to what other possibilities are out there. Both tonight with Crocker and Holyoke Gas and Electric, I think those were, and it certainly gave me a better understanding.
I do believe
the good point about this letter is the request for a YPRO's evaluation, right? I mean, that walking into that meeting and receiving it versus getting it 3 days before that meeting would be very helpful to me, I know. Yeah. I guess, personally, I would suggest at this late hour that perhaps you send it out and CC the board. And we'll go from there. And our reps.
My guess is after the 14th, we'll want a letter with even more information.
Yeah.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
And I think even if you signed it tonight and put it in the mail tomorrow, they are not going to get you the information that you need.
No, you're probably right, but at least it expresses the frustration that we have of the...
And I'm understanding you, you're also suggesting that sending a letter like this to some others that we in Ashfield are paying attention.
Yep.
And we would like something different in the information we're getting.
And we'd like them to be working in a more productive way instead of what seems like a destructive way, which is delaying this process in the way that they did.
Do you folks plan to go on the 14th? I'm going to be there. Okay. And I will.
I'm going to go there straight from work. They won't be there live, but I'll get there as fast as I can.
I think if you added words that members from our select board and our FinCom are going to be at that meeting, and I would like them to come prepared, will you please send us a PDF copy of the White Pro thing? I think that'd be really good to put in there. And then if they don't, then we'll take issue with it at that meeting. I mean, just walking into a code to be dictated to, I don't appreciate that.
I don't either.
I think your sending a letter is a fine idea. I don't know that you need to have the select board and the finance committee also sign it, but one of the things that's apparent to me is that the way they have publicized their approach, MBI, they came out with this document much earlier, was back on March 31st, about their whole process. And it makes it pretty stark. It says it's anticipated that many towns will choose Wired West to be their delegated agent for grant application and during construction, et cetera, et cetera. Thus, Wired West will submit its business plan and all that governance document and so forth. What they've done to date seems to indicate that they're prepared to kind of wipe that option right off the table. Although they can make some polite-sounding language about it, we can see if there's any adjustment to be made. But it's got a pretty dramatic impact. The second paragraph says, towns that choose to develop their own plans, submit their own applications, operate their own network, or find a different regional operator will also be required to submit an application with a detailed business and operating plan. So the step is that if we think Wired West is out of the game, that's what they think, the next step is for us to come up. So we now have to develop a business plan and a governance document and all this other sort of stuff to be ready to go. And I guess my question would be, I'd like to understand what it was about Wired West that was insufficient. We may agree or disagree about the validity of their business plan and stuff, but I'd like to understand what MBI found so deficient so that I have a better clue as to what we would be needing to do if we chose to go independently. Mm-hmm. And I think they owe it to people. They are an organization that I think is increasingly seem to be compelling a lot of reaction without offering a great deal of insightful or constructive leadership or help in this whole process. Even though they talk about we got $5,000 grants, we got money, we got advisors, we come out and help you guys. It was a telling remark that in the Wired West meeting, one of the comments was, how many people saw Wired West representatives at your meeting to pass the debt issue? Everybody raises their hand. How many saw MBI represented there? Nobody. They are one of these organizations that I'm afraid is getting to be tarred with this reputation of distant ownership of this whole process, and they kind of fiddle around and everybody jumps through the hoops. It's a little troubling. But I think the more of us that can be there at the 14th to hear what they have to say, it's good, and we ought to press them with it. I think that's right.
All right, so it sounds like I will just take this out of this meeting and send something on my own.
Yes, Chair. What I'll do is reach out between now and next week to cool it.
Okay.
And try to make them. I mean, they're in informal sessions now, so they're not in Boston very often. So.
Right.
I think more the representatives are there and that sort of thing.
Yeah, I think
if there's some rails being greased there, we ought to know about it.
I know that they're getting a lot of phone calls right now. But I think that's great because wherever they stand, I think they can serve a good role to step in and try to get this back on track and make sure that the key issues are not turf warfare or politics or whatever, but they can try to nail down what the key issues are and try to work them out.
And I wasn't exactly sure what Crocker was alluding to, but they said that all our reps are on board with whatever MBI has decided. What was that?
What was that? Oh, yeah, that was very surprising.
I didn't understand. It was a done deal, so don't worry about wireless because they're dead.
One source of information is...
Right. What's that?
You need to be cautious with one source of information.
No, right. But, so...
It was surprising. We certainly...
Heard from any of our band or...
It's the first time I heard that the legislators had any consensus on this issue of ownership.
Right. I've actually emailed to ask.
I did too.
Yeah.
I got a nice reply from Steve saying I'll get back to you. But.
Yeah, me too.
Out of the way. Obviously good.
So who was that?
Too cool.
To see?
Yeah. I wrote to him also. Yeah.
So what it appears like is that there's a disagreement over the connection points to the middle mile. Right? These folks are saying it's clearly understood that they can bypass that middle mile by having just a couple connection points to a consortium or a co-op. And that's what it came down to. So from MBI's point of view, if that is true, if there's that widespread agreement among the legislators and everything else, and the operating agreement has a business plan that isn't in accord with that, then maybe that's the point of focus, you know?
I believe that is the main point of contention. And you can understand that the legislators here in Western Massachusetts are very proud of the accomplishment that they have made in creating this middle mile, and they very much would also like to see that succeed as well. So it wouldn't surprise me if many of the legislators were in the position that Bill said. But I think it's important to get that nailed down. And in any case, even if this may still be useful battle, because in the end, Wired West is saying, if we had to connect in every location, it would be too expensive. Well, maybe the point of negotiation then is to adjust the rates so that this large municipal network that's connecting in 30 different places isn't paying through the nose like the current rates would require them to do so.
And do I understand that it was brought up in that same Saturday meeting that Wired West is made up of a bunch of representatives, just representatives to MBI, advisors, or I'm not sure of their capacity, and that there were none.
Wired West.
I'm sorry, not Wired West, MBI. MBI was made up of these folks, and that none of them were from the western part of the state. It was clearly said in that meeting.
You know, I thought it was too, but my understanding, I think that Linda Dunlap,
is a rep.
Is on either the MBI board or the MTC board.
No, we need to understand that a little bit.
It would be very good to know who is on the board of these organizations, for sure.
Just like a small kid with a connect the dots coloring book, I can do it backwards and come up with a totally different picture. But what I can see is that MBI ran all this fiber for the middle mile and all this other, and broke the market, right? They busted the market, broke the rates down, and they got the rates so low that if they don't get enough connection points, the future for MBI with no revenue is pretty dark.
Yes, that's very, very true. It connects, and part of the problem, it's not wholly their fault, but they had to respond to funding through the federal stimulus program that put a majority of the money in, which required them to build a middle mile. And they chose to build a middle mile to 123 towns, of which something like 100, so something like 80 of them or whatever, are fully served and have no need for this middle mile.
But then went and broke the market.
Right. And so, yes, they've got an asset that is probably struggling. They
need all those connections.
They need all those connections.
But they really want everybody else to take their advice on how to run their network.
That's right.
Well, Wired West, I think it was going to draw, characterize that
overbuilding, if you like, for a little while, is effectively a mistake that they're trying to cover now by ensuring that they get enough connections here to kind of make back the revenues that they otherwise would get. So there's a lot of interpretation going on both sides.
But I do find it interesting that, I mean, if this turns to be a long, protracted, very emotional type of deal that's not going to go forward,
yeah,
it's nice to know that we have options that we can move forward.
Assuming that the MBI is not so paralyzed by the politics with Wired West that it can't move forward on the
We could sign a letter today to MBI to say to design our network.
Maybe.
Huh?
I'm not sure if they would move forward with us or not. My understanding is they want some minimal number of towns to get going on.
How about 33?
I mean, just think what it was like when we were all sitting there at Berkshire East a year ago.
Exactly.
It was this come by all moment, and they said...
I went to the one over in New Salem. Todd says it was embarrassing. Felt like I was at a high school dance. Ted, do you have anything else?
Well, I would just... As much as I would hate to miss the balance of this meeting, if there's no further discussion of broadband in mind, I'd like to continue our finance committee in the other way long enough to approve one set of minutes.
There you go.
Absent ourselves from your gracious comment. Thank you.
Thanks for coming.
Thank you very much for including us.
Anything else, guys? It's quarter of 10 here.
What about schedule? I mean, we're almost up to the end of December here. Are we going to continue this broadband thing in January?
I'm trying to get it for next week.
Okay. Let's hold on.
We'll wait.
I don't have any. Let's see if first.
We're not meeting next week.
What does the 50th?
We should post in case we even deliberate on it.
What about the 50th? What do you guys schedule look like on the 50th?
I'm okay.
Yeah. 2 or 3.